This week, the U.S. Supreme Court was tasked with drawing the distinction between illegal threats made on social media and violent speech, which is protected by the First Amendment. Previous Supreme Court rulings have said the government can prohibit such threats, but what those threats are has never clearly been defined. Joining me to discuss this delicate issue, we welcome Caroline Mala Corbin, professor of law at the University of Miami School of Law. Thank you so much for being with us, Professor. What is the specific case in question?
So this case is about a federal law that makes it illegal to threaten someone with bodily harm. And the problem with this law is that there's more than one way to interpret it. So you could interpret it as saying, you violated the law as long as a reasonable person would think you've made a threat. That's sort of an objective approach to interpreting the law. Or you can interpret the law as, no, you haven't violated the law unless the person making the threat actually intended to frighten somebody. That's a sort of subjective intent approach to the law. And so there are two questions before the Supreme Court about this law banning threats. One is, which standard did the law choose? So it's sort of interpreting the statute question. And then there's the constitutional question, which is that law, does that law violate the free speech clause?
And of course, now that we get into this issue of social media and how that propagates, there is questions and concerns. There are some people who say that there is a difference between having something derogatory, or even what a reasonable person could say is a threat against a large, broad group. You can say harmful, hateful things about women, about gays, about men, about Hispanic ethnic groups, racial groups. That's absolutely protected in a very generic sort of way. But what is the value then, the difference in the value and risk when it's addressed to one specific person? And I think this is where we get into this one. It's addressed against one specific person.
Right, so the backdrop of the free speech question is that generally when you talk, you're allowed to say whatever you want. The government can't throw you into jail if you say something hateful or mean or nasty. So generally our speech is protected. But there are certain categories of speech where the idea is that the value of the speech is so low and the harm of the speech is so high that it really doesn't deserve free speech protection. And one of those categories of speech is threats. And so the court is sort of wrestling with defining the contours of that category.
And is it defined? Does it have to deal with also where the threat is presented, how it's decimated?
Well, this is the actual legal question is focused on how do we define a threat? Do we use an objective standard or do we use a subjective standard? Now, what a lot of people are focusing on is the issue that you've just raised, which is the context of the speech, right? Is it in the form of rap lyrics? Is it on Facebook? And that is a really important issue, but it's an important issue regardless of which standard the Supreme Court ultimately decides on. Because there's no denying that context is crucial in terms of deciding whether something is a threat. So if you're trying to determine subjective intent, it matters what the context is to trying to figure out what that person thought. And if you use the reasonable person standard, the assumption is that a reasonable person is aware of the context of the statement. So for example, it's a very different thing to say, I'm going to kill you if you're talking to your pal playing a video game, then if you say, I'm going to kill you, and you're talking to your estranged wife who's just taken a restraining order out on you.
Absolutely.
So and those are the sort of
context.
Context is key, right? And the fact that it's on Facebook is one of the contextual issues. The fact that it might be a song rather than a statement is one of the issues, but there are lots and lots of them.
And of course, somebody could argue that, and I'm sure that one of the arguments that are raised is that freedom of speech in a, has some restrictions. You cannot say fire in
exactly.
a crowded room.
Exactly.
The value of that freedom to be able to say that versus the risk and the harm that might come outweighs that value of being able to say fire when there is no fire. Of course, if there is one, then you know you definitely want to say that. But there's also other issues that you look at in the context that you can say, well, if you post it on social media, it's social, and you're letting everybody know an expression of anger, of hatred, and there's nothing hidden in the intent. So maybe that's also a cover to say, I'm not really trying to threaten you specifically. If I wanted to threaten you without anybody knowing, I wouldn't do it so everybody could see it. But yet we have had cases where that's precisely what has occurred.
Yeah, so again, the context of the statement is really important. And there are all different kinds of issues that matter for context. As you said, is it directed at a specific person or is it just a general statement?
How do you define a reasonable person?
And that is a fascinating issue and not actually the issue before the court. So I think now the court may opine on the issue, but the actual issue before the court is not what would a reasonable person think of a statement made on Facebook, but whether is that the question you should be asking when trying to decide whether something is a threat or not?
But yet at the same time, if you're using that standard, mm-hmm. how would a reasonable person interpret this? Mm-hmm. A reasonable person's reaction to that type of message today may be very different from what a reasonable person would have responded to 20, 25 years ago, because the message, the delivery of that message has changed dramatically. 25 years ago, you did not have social media, Facebook, for example, to deliver, or email to deliver that message. Today, that 25 years ago, that would have been verbally, face-to-face, telling other people, and or a physically written document. Today, through social media, texting, whatever, the mechanism, doesn't that make a difference?
Of course, as I said, it's one of the factors that you have to consider when you're analyzing context, and I think you have a very good point. Who is the reasonable person, right? Is it the reasonable person who's been the victim of domestic violence in the past? Is the reasonable person a teenager who's engaged in this kind of conversation? Those are all lots of questions. They're not actually before the court in this particular case.
So to go back again, what is exactly the court
trying to decide. So they're trying to decide how do we decide if there's a threat or not, right? Is the question.
And is this going to have an implication for how the federal government also defines a threat?
Well, again, the first question is, what did Congress mean when they passed this statute? That's sort of the first question. Okay. And depending on the answer to that question is, well, did Congress, in passing the statute, violate the free speech clause? So again, the two options that the court really seemed to be focusing on is this idea that it's not a violation unless the person who said it really intended to try and scare someone. So you're looking at the subjective intent of the person making the threat. That's the standard that the plaintiff wants to adopt because it's a little more narrow, as opposed to a more objective standard where the question is, it doesn't matter what you thought or what you wanted. What matters is, would a reasonable person think this is a threat?
What is a specific case? Who is the plaintiff here?
So the plaintiff here is a man who was very unhappy that his wife left him. And so he started posting a lot of very violent, you could say, threats against his wife, and she became afraid, and she took out an order of protection against him, and then he continued making threats against her, often in the form of lyrics, though. So again, things that you have to consider when you're making when you're sort of analyzing it, the contextual issues. It's on Facebook, so in the form of lyrics. At the same time,
mentions her specifically and not anyone else.
Specifically, he continued making these threatening comments after she had gotten an order of protection against him. Right. So there are a lot of factors to consider. So no one factor is going to be decisive.
I wonder if order of protection could possibly someday be expanded so that it includes the prohibition. But you see, then you get into it all would depend on what this Supreme Court decision
says.
And so that it would impede you from being able to threaten online.
There are definite repercussions for whatever standard the court adopts. Because on the one hand, if it adopts the subjective intent, right, there's a real risk that if you define threats too broadly, you might end up chilling valuable speech, right? You might have a person who previously might have been willing to write a threat that was critical of the government. So they might have been willing to do a sort of satirical or exaggerated threat, criticizing the government, which is the kind of speech you want to encourage under the free speech clause. But now they're going to hold back because they're going to worry, well, what if a reasonable person thinks this is a threat? And we've lost some valuable free speech.
Define,
on the other hand,
how
wait,
do you
let
define
me just.
Threat?
On the other hand, the risk is if you define threat narrowly and require subjective intent, then you run the risk of something that looks like a threat and walks like a threat and talks like a threat and a reasonable person would think is a threat is not treated like a threat. So then you have people, then you've just allowed someone to threaten someone and put them in fear and force them to disrupt their lives, but it's still allowed. So it's sort of, it's a tough call because there's liberty interests on both sides.
And we'll be watching that case and having you back to discuss that. Thanks so much for joining me today, Professor Corbin.